Thema Spezial. Was tun gegen den Klimawandel?
Wir als Menschheit haben heute die Wahl. Stehlen wir die Zukunft oder heilen wir sie?
Klimaaktivist Cyril Dion entdeckt lokale Strategien gegen die globale Krise.
Wir wollen durch den Schutz bestehender Wälder einen Beitrag leisten, aber vor allem durch die Wiederaufforstung geschädigter oder zerstörter Wälder.
Es ist für diese Menschen wichtig, sich autonom versorgen zu können.
Eine neue Welt. Alle drei Dokumentationen jetzt online auf arte.tv.
Bonsoir.
Merci. Bonsoir.
Bonsoir. Let me introduce you to the audience. Your CV is quite impressive. Thierry Robert works for the main French production companies, France Télévisions, Arte, and other international television channels. He has received numerous awards and prizes for his films. Films about polar expeditions in the form of travel diaries, but also about the issues of tomorrow, climate change, biodiversity, the relationship with nature, scientific discoveries. Like, you have a lot of projects.
Thank you so much.
You had a lot of projects, and all of them are very interesting, especially for us here at Globe 22. For example, your film The Grand Crossing received 7 international awards, I believe. Very impressive. Or Voyage to Forbidden Tibet, the Grand Prix in Montreal. And also you had a huge climate research around North America, is the name of it. Also got numerous prizes. So yeah, we're very lucky to have you here tonight.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
I will try one sentence in French once again. Merci beaucoup pour ce film très émouvant et très passionnant. Thierry, je continue en anglais.
Vielen Dank. Merci beaucoup.
Yeah,
thanks a lot.
We have just seen part one of the 3-part film series, A New World. Part one, Resistance, and you told me beforehand we have to watch, of course, 3 parts to get the full picture. But still,
yeah, because the whole thing is quite positive. It doesn't look much like in this first episode, which is quite dark. But we had to go back into the situation we're in, and I mean, but please.
Yes, of course. But I think it's important to show how people resist and how people demonstrate and fight. So it's dark, but a very important message also that we need to hear. So let me start with this question. How did this film project, A New World, with you and Cyril Dion that we saw in the movie, how did it start?
Well, it started with Cyril, because I don't know if you know him, but he's very famous in France. He is an activist, poet, a writer, a filmmaker. And in 2015, he did a film called Demain in French, Tomorrow. Morgen, I guess, in German.
Yes, that's right.
And so this film did very well. He received the César Award in France, which is really big for that. And after all these years, 2 years ago, he did a film, also a movie theater called Animal. Which did quite well. And in the meantime, he had started writing this story. We call in French, Un monde nouveau à une nouvelle Welt, a new world. And so, of course, there was no way for him he could direct this. He was too busy on so many things. And we have a producer in common, Fabrice Papillon, who's one guy from Galaxy. And Fabrice said, well, Cyril, you definitely must work with Thierry on this one, especially. He's done a lot of things about the climate, especially on Arte. And and then we met, and there was a match. You know, it was beautiful. So we immediately understood each other and started this beautiful story.
Sounds perfect. Sounds like a perfect match, I guess. Both of you.
It is. You know, it's quite surprising because we, you know, it's like it was about like 2 years writing, you know, investigating with a huge team of journalists, scientific journalists, investigating. When I came in, there was like a first draft of scenario, which was a script. I mean, was pretty good. But then I was, you know, I mean, it was not very well balanced. And then I had to rewrite this, you know. And then the COVID started. And we had to go throughout the world to shoot all this. So in regular time, it would be really difficult to do such a film. I mean, such 3 films, because like you said, they work all together. In the COVID time, it was it looked like a nightmare. Wow. But we had this perfect match from the beginning, and then the whole story was like a kind of miracle. And, you know, step by step, we could shoot it. We had to rethink the way to shoot. For example, I've been around the world for all the films I did, so I knew people mostly everywhere. And we started thinking, okay, let's try to have some local crews, and they could be direct. I mean, you know, somebody like in between me and these guys. And I started, you know, to write a mood board, artistic and technical, to explain everything, the kind of shots I wanted, etc. And then we did a script per sequence, very detailed. And we would drop that to them, and then I would speak to them over, you know, like video calls, and some direction of some sequence we did, you know, live, through video.
Video calls.
Yeah,
wow.
Exactly. Some of them. Yeah. So
that sounds very hard.
So yeah, we started thinking a different way to shoot things, and of course it was also part of, you know, the topic of this film, and that's how I invented this, you know, the cabin in the woods, the hut in the woods, where Cyril goes back and forth, and that's where he can think about what's going on and think about, you know, the previous subject of a sequence and you know, drop the next one.
It's quite interesting what you say. I mean, it's, and in the end, it is a global issue. And also at this festival, we talk about solidarities and climate solidarities. So I guess like the shooting of this film is a perfect example for this.
Exactly.
For this
model. And now, you know, the COVID is over, I mean, mostly. But we think we found something. And we think about, you know, to keep and that way reduce our impact, you know, and we think about keeping shooting like that.
Oh, it's very, very interesting. So despite all obstacles, you managed to shoot such a film and also to gain like new experience on
exactly
how to actually shoot a film internationally. And maybe, yeah, I mean, it's also good if you don't have to travel everywhere yourself.
Exactly.
You reduce your own emissions while shooting a film. So I guess that's very interesting. So you met a lot of different people while shooting this film. Like what or who impressed you the most, if you can say that? Maybe just about part one, because that's what we saw.
Part one, I would say Paul Hawken in the San Francisco Bay Area. This man is a very famous American writer and ecologist. And yeah, he was great. That was such a meeting. But you know, during all these films, we met so many people. I mean, there are so many incredible people. So like I said, the first part is quite dark, but the second one is about adaptation, to adapt to the world we're in now. We really understood maybe this summer that we're really into this big, big climate change. And the last part, like you said, it's called Regenerate. And of course, it's a lot of, you know, beautiful initiatives and solutions. So the whole story is quite positive. But we wanted to start, like you said, in reality. And the reality is quite dark. And also, we love these people, these activists we met. We may very well organize a huge screening in Lützerath, You know, Lützerath is one small village near the mine. And I don't know if you know, but recently there was an article in the Der Spiegel, I could read last week. Your Minister of Economy, Robert Habeck, I think, and he's in charge of the climate. he said they will, you know, in the film, Katrin Henneberger, she says that they allow the mine to keep going until 2038. So the minister said they will stop in 2030. But in the meantime, Lützerath is dead. So they're gonna, you know, dig Lützerath. So very probably we're gonna all go and do like some, I don't know, festival and screening.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, something special.
Do you know
there.
When already?
I know, but okay. I can't say for the
Maybe
moment.
Maybe you will tell us later, like not on stage, but at the bar. Well, you just told me what like impressed you the most, and it's many different things. But
yeah, like I said, even these activists, I mean, it's so crazy. And we talked about Germany right now, but when you're right next to this mine and you see all these people in the trees, everywhere in the old farms, and they just, I mean, it's crazy. You know, I live in the south of France in a beautiful environment. You know, suddenly you think about these people, they live right next to such a mine, which is complete nonsense, and you know, climate. I mean, it's a total disaster. So yeah, that was really, really impressive. Also, I mean,
is there something that surprised you the most during the work on part one? Like something you, even though you had been working on climate issues in other films, like was there something you didn't know before that really shocked you or surprised you, maybe or even in a good way surprised you?
Well,
or in a bad way, I guess.
Yeah, both. I mean, because the end of the film, the last third of the film is quite positive, and we start talking about solutions with Paul Oaken and what happens with this man, Eduardo Malta in Brazil, you know, reforesting with the Muvuca technique, which is crazy, you know, he's dropping so many seeds in a small hole and there are so many trees coming out of that. All that was crazy. All these things were beautiful. Even this cook in France, you know, is in a small city called Millau, south of France, and he's in charge of, you know, a cooking meal for 1,300 kids every day. So, and that was quite a lot. When you think about all these organic, you know, food in the school for the schools. Usually, in big cities, everybody thinks, okay, this is impossible. When it's too big, you cannot do it. Mm. And he proves that it's possible. Yeah. And then even bigger in Brazil, they did it, and it's so huge. So, to me, I mean, what we wanted to tell with Cyril is the whole thing, the whole series, the whole new world. We try to propose is a kind of a story of a potential beautiful world we could live in. So we just have to think it differently.
Yeah, thank you. I want to ask all of you, the audience, do you have any questions that you would like to ask Thierry Robert? So he's asking if you have plans to reach a larger audience with the movie, because like not everyone is watching Arte, and they often show these kind of films like late at night, and even like not everyone, it will be in the media library, but not everyone's checking that. Do you have projects like, will you go to schools or?
Sure, sure we will. But film? You know, this is prime time on Arte, and it's going to be a big deal. In France, they're doing such a press campaign with all this. I guess, you know, Arte, there is the TV channel, but there is also the platform on the web. And it can be, that's the kind of film that could do a really, really a big audience. We think it could be millions, because with the press campaign they're doing, and including the platform. And of course, we are distributed worldwide, so the film is going to go everywhere, you know, mostly. And yes, for sure, we will go to schools, you know, high schools, universities, wherever possible. Yeah. We even go to Lützerath once again.
Yeah.
Donc merci beaucoup pour ce film hyper important et très beau, très intéressant à voir.
It's really a wonderful movie and really well put together and super informative, so important. My question for you is, you talked about how the films are ultimately very positive. I actually found this film actually quite positive as well, focused on solutions. I wanted to ask you if you feel like you can tell us, after all of the research that you did and all of the travel that you did and the people you spoke with, did you ultimately feel optimistic or pessimistic? So that's my question.
Well, that's the question we get very often. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for what you said, for your comment about the film. Well, it depends on you know, the days. Some days I'm quite pessimistic when I see where we're going and all the crazy things. You know, there is like this World Cup, football World Cup in Qatar. There is the crazy thing they just allowed Saudi Arabia, you know. So many things are going wrong. And some days it's really hard to be optimistic. But, and because we've been through a lot of things and we met so many people, I'm quite optimistic that we can do it. And I'm quite optimistic that that kind of film, you know, a few years ago, when I did the Climate Odyssey around North America, that was like the beginning of the kind of films. And there, it was, at this time, was quite positive. There was many, many things. And there was the Al Gore film, which was really, really dark. He got the Oscar for that one. Then Cyril came in, and there was Demain, so Tomorrow. And when he did Tomorrow, and to me, when I saw his movie, there was such hope. And I remember, I would say it spread throughout French society. And I know he's been quite everywhere with this film, and so many people saw it, and so many people told me, wow, you know, it changed my mind. And hopefully, and I think that's what we do with this new word, we try to open, I mean, something in people's consciousness, and I mean, even young people, you know, it's very important, but even old people, we try to like I said, tell them a story of a future we would love to live in. And for that, I'm quite optimistic that, you know, like step by step, we will do it before it's too late.
Yeah, I think that's very an interesting point, and also maybe different perception of things, that maybe people who want a change are not the minority. Maybe they are the majority. I don't know, like maybe
exactly.
There are more people who want...
But it's so difficult to change, you know, and all these films are very political. You know, we're... I mean, Cyril and I, when we started this story, we thought, I don't know exactly the situation in Germany, but I know very well what's going on in France. And believe me, people just can't anymore. You know, these days there is the oil strikes, you know, in big refineries. You know what, the one we see, where we shot with Andreas Malm, this Swedish teacher. That one is closed, that's where the whole thing started. So. People get crazy. I mean, nobody understands what's going on. The CEO of Total last year doubled his salary. The guy was making $3 million a year. Now he's making $6 million during like the COVID period, and they refuse to raise a little bit salaries for the people working for them. And they make such. I mean, I don't know if you know that, but in France, there were. Billions and billions of profits made during the COVID crisis. So people just don't understand what's going on. In France, there is kind of, to me, there is a kind of revolution feeling these days. People are going crazy, and we can feel, you know, Macron was re-elected, but most people, I would say, probably 80%, even maybe more, people don't trust his policy, his politics, and you know, the there's no more democracy in a big country like France. So all this makes me feel that, and that's what we tried to say with Cyril in this first episode, the whole system has to change. It's it's just the whole thing is dead, you know, we can't live anymore like that. And I feel many people are really willing to change that system. But for the moment, we don't know how it's going to go, if it's going to be ultra-violent, or if, like we say later in the film, it could be totally non-violent, but a complete change of system.
Yeah, but also in the film, you addressed the feelings of powerlessness several times. Cyril addresses it, but also the different protagonists address that feeling. I would like to ask you, how do you personally deal with that feeling, like with those feelings of powerlessness?
Well, like I said, some days are worse than others. yeah, sometimes I'm quite optimistic, you know, that's the way I am. And so some days I'm not too, at ease with all this. And even, you know, the idea of changing the way our democracy works, this is really big. But when you think about it, the way it works, it's a kind of story we mostly all agree to. And I mean, the story is completely fake. And I guess people get conscious of that fakeness and suddenly realize we can invent a brand new word and live into that word.
Thank you.
So that what takes me, you know, optimistic.
Still up. Are there any more questions from the audience? Yes. Okay, I will try to summarize that question in English. Thank you for your question. So he says that you showed like the movements in this film, but he's asking if you're also interested in doing a film that shows like how capitalism has to change or should change, and how we need like a completely different system, economic system, and to show like solutions and ideas for that. Is that okay so far?
Yeah, that's what we show at the end of the third movie. We go to the University of Yale in the U.S. and there we meet Helen Landmore. She's a French American teacher, science politics, and she's the one saying that there's no more. I mean, she. It's crazy because she's not like an activist. You would see her in the street. You would, you know, she's like the regular woman. And then she says there is no more democracy in France. She's really aware of all that, and what she believes in. She wrote a book called Open Democracy, and she believes a lot in what the Irish did. And then we went in Ireland to film. The people who organized the citizen convention, and they did many citizen convention in Ireland, and from that they could change the constitution. And there was an experiment in France, but it didn't work. It worked for months. Macron was behind. He was like acting like, yeah, it's very important. Citizen went with many proposal. And at the end, the parliament said no to everything. So that example was very bad. But because it didn't go up to a referendum. Mm. But in Ireland, they went to the referendum many times, and then people voted. And at the beginning, they expected that maybe it wouldn't change anything, and it worked very well. They really changed many big parts of their constitution. Mm. So we really believe in things like that. Yeah.
Okay, I guess that answered your questions. Question: Are there any more questions from the audience? Okay.
Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, you want a glass of? Then I would like to ask two more questions. The film conveys a clear message, act somehow. Do you have a specific goal in mind that you would like your film or your film project to reach?
Like I said, the goal is that people are aware of what's going on and become aware and conscious of their power and of their capability to really change the world we're in. And yeah, to me, that's the message and that's the deep hope we have. But I'm not, you know, I'm not just crazy and I don't, how can I say that? It's quite difficult because I'm speaking in English, but I'm not crazy enough to think that it will change the world. But yeah, but I think it will a bit. Thank you.
So let me ask you one last question that I'm really curious about, which like some people stated in your film, they said the only real resistance is radical. Like peaceful resistance is not enough. What is your opinion on that?
Well, I'm getting close to what Andreas Malm says, and this guy was very impressive too.
Yes,
he's another one. He was so nice. I'm getting close to him because what he said is, it's what he explained in the film. But all these peaceful movements, which we all remember, there was always a part of violence. And what he explains very well in his book is called How to Blow Up a Pipeline, which is a very funny title, but he doesn't give you exactly the way to do it, but he should maybe. But yeah, what he explains is that it's always because of this little part of violence on the side that these big peaceful movements could make it. So yeah. I'm worried. You know, in France, there was the yellow vest. You know, three years ago. And at the beginning, it almost started like the situation we're in today, but it was way better than today. And people got desperate, and they started, and it went very bad because the answer from the government was complete nonsense. So yeah, I'm worried, and that's what I said when we started this discussion tonight. I'm worried, in France these days, the situation may go very bad, I don't know, very badly, yeah. We'll see.
We'll see, I guess, but yeah, what all of us will definitely watch, I guess, is part two and three.
Hopefully they see the film before.
Yeah. Yeah, hopefully they see the film before, not just part one, but also part two and three to get an optimistic.
It will be on Arte on November the 15th.
Yes, I was going to say that.
Both in France and Germany.
Yes.
And it's prime time, it's in the evening. And I think, I don't know, in France they do it, it's going to be on the platform even a week before.
Yes, they will do that. I
same
don't know
in Germany,
the exact
I think so,
date,
yeah.
But they put it on the Arte Mediathek before the premiere. Yes, so yeah, I think all of us after this first part, all of us are very hooked and can't wait to see part two and three, and we will do that in a few weeks when it's
thank
out
you.
There. So yeah, thank you so much
thank
for
so
coming
much.
To our Science Festival to Globe 22, Thierry. Thank you so much for discussing with us and for your interesting answers. Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thank you very much for welcoming me. Thanks to be here.